In the anterior compartment of the leg, it's open, it's unknown.
Oh, what?
What muscle do you think would be responsible for shin splints? I'm not gonna tell you right or wrong, I'm just saying, so, these are things you should probably think about. Inversion injury of the ankle, why?
Less leg.
The spring would be the most injured.
That would be really wrong.
It's because you have the deltoid, which protects the other.
Oh, it's the anterior.
What's the name of the ligament?
The deltoid.
Yeah, so the deltoid ligament is on, goes on one side.
Right, that protects it from rolling.
That's a strong one to prevent.
The medial's side, so the lateral side is what's the, Julie, what's the?
Anterior talofibular.
Anterior talofibular.
That's your common one.
Plantar fasciitis. What would you do to work it out?
Stretch.
What?
What would you do?
Plantar flexion, tell me what muscles cause plantar flexion. That's putting your foot down.
Gastrocnemius, soleus.
Posterior compartment muscles, what other compartment muscles? Lateral compartment muscles, right? Posterior, you okay, Sophia?
Yes.
Sophie or Sophia?
Either or, most people call me Sophie.
Sophie.
Sophia's.
So, if you had hallux valgus, which direction would the toe point? What is that?
Lateral.
Because valgus is out, right? Like genu valgus is like out, so that's lateral. Where do you palpate the dorsalis pedis pulse?
Medial side.
Where?
Top of the foot?
On the dorsal of your pedis, on the top of your foot, right? Where do you palpate the posterior tibialis?
Medial side.
In front of or behind the medial valgus?
Behind.
Posterior two behind, yes. So if you had a DVT in your popliteal vein, it suddenly appeared, what do you think your leg would do?
It
would be bigger. You would have swelling of the calf, okay? Swelling of the calf. Would you have an arterial pulse? Yeah, you still have an arterial pulse. You'd have pain, right? Obviously. So what if you blocked off the popliteal artery? What would happen then?
No pulse.
What's that?
No pulse.
No pulse. No pulse. What would the, if you had no pulse, what do you think the temperature of the skin would be?
Cold.
Cold versus the DVT, it would be warm. Okay. It's amazing how many people that goes by them. So I would pay a little bit of attention to muscles that act on one joint versus two joints. How many joints does the tensor fascia lata act on?
Two.
What's the pes and serine?
That's the three.
The three muscles, which are the three muscles? The sartorius, the psoas, and the semitendinosus. You can also inject that with steroids if it's painful. I don't know if I mentioned that. What do you think? You remember I drew those arteries of the knee on the board? superior, medial, superior lateral geniculate. Where do you think they arise from? Or do they arise from? Huh? Popliteal. Because it's a knee, right? Okay. Femoral sheath. That's the whole thing, right? What's in the most medial compartment? In fact, what's in the most lateral compartment? The artery. What compartment is the nerve in?
None.
Good. What's the unhappy triad?
ACL.
Medial collateral. What quadricep has an axon of two muscles? What'd you say? The rectus femoris. Do the others? No, they arise from the femur. Where do the hamstrings arise?
Tuberosity.
Somebody said the tuberosity. Yeah. If I was going to give you an IM injection in your butt, where would I put it? Upper quadrant. So let's talk about the acetabulum for a minute. The acetabulum, what's more concave, the glenoid cavity or the acetabulum? What closes the loop of the lunate surface? Transverse, what'd you say?
Acetabulum.
Yes, or the transverse acetabulum. I thought you, Sophie, were going to say ligament to the head of the femur.
I just said transverse. That was only.
Transverse is good, right? Where's the ligament of the head of the femur arise from that transverse acetabulum ligament? What's inside the ligament of the head of the femur? Right, branch of the what artery? Obturator artery. How does the artery get to inside the ligament of the head of the femur?
It goes up.
It goes up, but how does it go get to up?
Fovea.
No, it goes through the fovea, yeah, but how does it get into the acetabular fossa? What'd you say? Well, it goes through the obturator foramen, and the obturator artery goes to supply the adductor muscles. And it sends a branch over into the acetabulum. How does it get into the ligament of the head of the femur? How does it get into the acetabulum? Think about it for a minute. Think about it. Just stop. Don't say anything. Think about it for a minute. If you've got the lunate surface and the transverse acetabular ligament here, and this big ball sitting in there, that ligament cannot go by the ball to get in there. Where is the defect that would allow the artery to get into the acetabulum? Where?
Under the transverse
acetabular ligament. That's how it gets in. It goes in there and it enters the ligament of the head. Way to go, Ronnie. Okay. So if I, okay, I've got the femoral nerve and the common peroneal nerve. Which one, if I wanted to knock out the most muscles, which one would I cut? All right, so what does the femoral innervate? And how many muscles? I asked you, how many muscles?
Checked out
this question. I would recheck in this question because you're probably going to get a very similar question. So you might want to know what innervates what.
Mm-hmm.
So the femoral gets the quadriceps, gets the sartorius, gets half of the adductor magnus, right? That's 5.5. The common peroneal, well, let's see, it branches into the superficial and deep. The superficial gets the peroneus longus and peroneus brevis. The deep gets the tibialis anterior, the extensor digitorum longus, the extensor hallucis longus, the peroneus tertius. That's it. It's the common peroneum. Okay? How about if you transected the sciatic nerve versus the femoral nerve? Okay, well, those six plus the four hamstrings. Okay? All you got to know is which nerve, you don't have to know which nerve innervates which muscle. All you got to know is which nerve innervates which compartment. And what muscles are in the compartment? The only exception is the adductor magnus is split. Half femoral, half obturator, right? What tendon or ligament inserts right there?
Patellar ligament.
What is that? Now there is a condition, and I forgot to mention it, where, what is this bony prominence? Yeah, tibiotuberosity. There is a condition called Osgood Schlatter disease. S-C-H-L-A-T-T-E-R, apostrophe S. I don't know if it was on one of the slides. Was it on one of the slides? Osgood Schlatter disease happens in young boys, and it's where the tibial tuberosity starts fragmenting, you know, pulling away. And it's a very painful condition in young boys, athletic kind of boys, in the order of shin splints. So it usually resolves over time without doing anything, but you probably should Google Osgood Schlatter disease. You'll see it a lot. Okay, so let's talk about your stuff. So I'm going to say an organ or a structure. And you tell me, is it superficial or deep to the UG diaphragm? Okay? I'm going to name a structure. You just say superficial. Hey, so here's two things. One is my group with the humanities. I'd like your papers the night before so I can read them before the event, okay? Huh? Yeah, next Tuesday. You write it Tuesday.
All right.
The other thing is the people out here, they're related to the science side of the arts and sciences. They're good. So I'm all for them. Okay. So I'm going to say, so I won't be going medieval on them. They're good. So if it's superficial or deep to the UG diaphragm, are you ready? Bulbourethral gland. Kind of a trick question. Because it's within the UG diaphragm. External urethral sphincter. External, what are two things inside? What two things make up the UG diaphragm? That plus the deep transverse perineus muscle. That's another trick question. It's the same level. Prostate gland. Deep. It's deep to it. The bulb of your penis. Superficial. Perineal membrane. It's superficial, because it's the perineal membrane, and then the UG diaphragm, right? Opening of the ejaculatory duct. Deep, because where's the opening of the ejaculatory duct? The prostate. Cervix. It better be deep, otherwise stuff is going to start falling out of you. What part of the female anatomy goes through the UG diaphragm? It's the vagina. Yeah. How about the pelvic diaphragm? Is the cervix superficial and deep to the pelvic diaphragm? If it's superficial, you're going to be dragging it along as you walk. It's deep. You got to have stuff on the other side of the muscle, otherwise it'll fall out. Okay? Well, let's talk about the pelvic diaphragm. That mental picture of falling out. Ron got it because he was over here grinning. Let's talk about the pelvic diaphragm. What is a portion of the pelvic diaphragm that's not a portion of the levator diaphragm? Yeah. I mean, later it may not. Coccygeus.
Ischio.
You said ischio. You said ilio, though, right?
Ischio. Ischio.
Okay, ischio, coccygeus. Right. What's part of the pelvic diaphragm that's not part of the puborectal sling? You can say both, the iliococcygeus and the ischiococcygeus. Puborectal sling is just made up of the pubococcygeus, right? What innervates the pelvic diaphragm? What innervates the pelvic diaphragm? So you're talking about the parasympathetic preganglionic? Which is what nerve? Pudendal nerve. Pudendal nerve. So it's somatic. Right? How about the UG diaphragm? What innervates that? Pudendal. It's still the pudendal. I mean, you can, you know, draw up your mess. You can contract your diaphragm, right? What's the terminal branch of the pudendal nerve? Dorsal nerve of the whichever you have. Sophie, if you had hemorrhoids,
yes.
Would they be arterial or venous? Venous. Julie, if you had a Bartholin cyst, where would it be? For anybody, I don't need to pick it. Ron, if you had a Bartholin cyst, be in the labia majora. Yeah, labia majora. Yeah. That's also a funny thing to imagine, isn't it? Tell me something that attaches to the perineal membrane. Your external junk, right? Male or female, your external junk. Give me some part of your junk. It's your labia, yeah. What surrounds the Bartholin's gland? What muscle?
The
bulbo spongiosus. That one thing that attaches there, right? How about in Zane here? What attaches there?
The similar
structure.
Bulbo
spongiosus or the bulbous venous. What else attaches there?
Ischia?
Yeah, the crura attached there with the muscle that's around the crura, which is the
ischio.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Okay.
Would the sphincter be there as well?
suspensory ligament of the penis or the clitoris?
Yeah.
No. It attaches to the pubic bone.
Okay.
But close. So, okay, so back to the UD diaphragm. Superficial UD. Spongy urethra.
Superficial.
Prostatic urethra. And what would be at the same level? The membranous urethra. Let's switch gears and talk about some papillomavirus for just a second. Can we do that? Just for a few minutes. If you block an artery going to an organ, like the lung, what is the shape of the infarct area, typically?
Wedge.
Yeah, it's like a wedge. The point of the wedge is where the artery enters and distributes. So it's a wedge-shaped defect would be an arterial embolus or something like that. What drug has an effect on ADP in terms of?
That's
Plavix. Plavix. How does aspirin work?
TXV. That TXA2.
Yeah. What does that stand for?
Thromboxane
A2. Yeah. What's the function of the GP2B3A receptor? Right, it binds fibrinogen and aggregates platelets, right? When you talk about the intrinsic and extrinsic pathways, which one is measured by a PT? Extrinsic. So intrinsic is measured by what? PTT. Which one is vitamin K dependent?
Intrinsic.
I keep hearing intrinsic.
Extrinsic.
Vitamin K, and what's the drug that affects it? Coumadin. So vitamin K, Coumadin, PT. Another thing you'll learn later, the PT is the more favored test now is called the INR. It's called the International Normalized Ratio. But you don't need to know that. If you had an overdose of heparin, how would you treat it? Protamine zinc, yep. What's hemophilia B deficiency? What's that? Nine. How about A?
A.
Which one's Christmas?
Nine.
Or B. Okay. What creates? How do you measure fibrin split products?
D-dimer.
A D-dimer. What creates fibrin split products? What?
Plasma.
Say it again.
Plasma.
Yeah. If I were going to give you something to create fibrin split products, what would I give you?
Isn't that 13?
What?
Is it 13?
No, if I was going to give you something, a drug, heparin only prevents clotting. What drug that I mentioned is used to treat strokes and heart attacks?
TPA.
TPA. And TPA will create fibrin split products because it's going to bust the clot, right? So, if I had a big old, if I ran into this table and wound up with these two big bruises right here, what layer of the skin would those bruises be in? subcutaneous, what would you call those lesions? Ecchymoses. So, if you had hemolytic anemia, what do you think hemolytic anemia is? What do you think it is? Without ever even covering it, what do you think hemolytic anemia is? Yeah, it's a decrease, it's an anemia because you're breaking down red blood cells. Hemolytic, hemolysis of red blood cells. What pigment do you think would accumulate in your body?
Bilirubin.
Okay, bilirubin. Bilirubin could do it. Your that could do it, yeah. Because you're releasing all this hemoglobin. What else could? What other pigment is related to? You what?
Why would bilirubin?
Well, if you break, well, bilirubin is an end product of hemoglobin.
Oh yeah, that's right. That's right.
Yeah. But what else is a part of hemoglobin? It's related to iron. You women who are menstruating, the number one cause of anemia in people your age, and a lot of you are anemic, is iron deficiency anemia because of menstruation. Right? And old guys like me, I didn't mean to point at you. I meant the number one cause of iron deficiency anemia is, believe it or not, GI bleeding from cancer. You got to rule out cancer. In babies, infants, the number one cause of iron deficiency anemia is giving them formula without iron. So getting back to hemolytic anemia, what is the name of the pigment that contains iron?
Hemosiderin.
Somebody said hemosiderin. So if you had hemolytic anemia, you might expect to find some hemosiderin around somewhere. What's lipofuscin? It's a garbage pigment. What color is it?
Yellowish.
Yeah. That's all I got. What do you got? You got any questions?
Can you verify if the obturator canal and the pudendal canal are the same thing?
Yes. You can consider them the same thing.
Okay. Because I thought the pudendal canal only goes to the lesser sciatic foramen and the obturator.
The pudendal canal starts on the up. The pudendal canal is not associated with the lesser sciatic foramen.
The whole internet said.
Well, the internet's right or wrong.
The pudendal canal
is formed by the internal fascia of the obturator internus producing a canal.
So I thought it was on the outside. Only the pudendal stuff goes through the pudendal canal. The obturator canal has its own obturator stuff in it. So why are you saying they're the same thing? Because that's blowing my mind. I'm just saying to consider the same thing. The obturator canal is in the obturator internus muscle. Yeah, it's like they're next to each other, but they like carry different things.
Obturator foramen is.
Suffice it to say, did I bring up the pudendal canal during our discussion?
Yeah.
Let it go, Sophie.
I'll stop caring.
Okay? The canal that's produced from the obturator internus muscle.
Yes.
You can call it the pudendal canal because it contains the pudendal. You can call it the obturator canal because it's in the obturator muscle. Let it go. Okay? It has nothing to do with the obturator foramen and the obturator nerve in the front of your pelvis. Okay? We're going to go with it. Okay? We're going to go with that. Okay. Any other questions?
All right, one last thing about that. Okay, so the obturator nerve artery and vein, you can go through that obturator like defect or from the back of the eye, but that is not called the obturator canal. That's just called the obturator lumen.
I would just rather you prefer to call it the obturator foramen.
All right, we're good then. We're good. All right.
It has no clinical significance. In fact, the only significance of the obturator is that the pudendal canal has is if you're going to do a pudendal block, that's where you go for the nerve just before it enters the canal. So that's why I don't want to get it.
Yeah.
Anything else?
No.
Wait.
Did you want us to know the details, like super details of the clotting cascades, or just the ones that you like specifically mentioned in class?
No, I said you didn't have to know. I mean, I think you should know that, okay, you got an extrinsic and intrinsic and all that stuff I mentioned earlier. You know, they come down and there's 10 right there, and then you get down a few more, and then you've got there's a thrombin that's eventually made that creates, that catalyzes fibrinogen into fibrin, and then 13's involved that cross links it. You know, just a big part.
Okay.
You don't have to know all of them.
But not all of
them.
Because
all the
slides
are some.
Right.
Because on the slides there's some.
Cool.
We'll just go with what I'll probably do on the test is like give you picture of it with none of the Roman numerals on it. You put them all in.
So you mentioned Coumadin, aspirin, and Plavix, but you also mentioned a couple other drugs. Are those as important as those three? I couldn't catch the name of them, so.
TPA, heparin, Coumadin.
Well, besides those, there was like four. I can't remember the name. I didn't even know how to spell it.
Oh, like Reteplase?
Yeah.
Yeah, how do they work? What's that? Yeah, but what enzyme are they going after? What do they inhibit?
TPA?
I think you're saying what?
Is it TPA?
No, not TPA.
Is that
No.
I know it's when you get
Reteplase and Alteplase. They inhibit the GP2B3A. Okay?
I'm sorry, what is that called? That inhibits
GP2B3A? It's called, the most common one really is called Reteplase, Reteplase. Reteplase, there's an Alteplase, and then there's another one with a bigger name. You'll be using these drugs a lot. Yeah, they inhibit the block. Okay.